Today, amongst other things, I'll explain to you what SpaceX is doing to fix the engine problem on Starship Serial Number 8, and I'll give you a detailed launch summary for the SpaceX and NASA Crew 1 Dragon launch.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Looks like it's handled.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix, and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. Hello, Y family. What a week. SpaceX is flexing muscles again and demonstrating to everyone in the launch business that their lead is increasing with every month that goes by. Keep in mind that we're talking about a private company here. And this private company means business. There is no other development project comparable to what SpaceX is doing here in South Texas. More and more prototypes are being developed and built at a speed that's never been there before. RGV aerial photography was up in the air again for all of us, taking some absolutely fantastic pictures of both the construction site and the launch facility. Make sure to follow him on Twitter and consider becoming a flight supporter on his Patreon page. He earned it. What you're looking at here is SpaceX's high bay at the South Texas construction site. Its purpose is to give a controlled and protected environment for super heavy construction. SpaceX's 72-meter-tall reusable rocket booster that will push Starships into orbit. And if we look at it from a slightly different angle, we can get a glimpse of what's happening inside at the moment. Let me introduce you to Super Heavy Booster Number 1. Growing fast in the SpaceX high bay, it will be the first of its kind, and according to Elon Musk, it will do a 150-meter hop. When this first flight will happen is not clear yet, and this year doesn't seem likely right now. Very early next year, though, does seem achievable. From a special angle, right next to the high bay in front of the smaller mid-bay, Mauricio managed to take a very nice shot of Starship Serial Number 11's common dome segment, including the methane header tank. And it's always interesting to get these rare shots as it gives us a clue at how exactly work is being performed on the inside. One worker can be seen standing on top of the methane header tank, which is integrated into the common dome. At the launch site, the main focus is still on Starship Serial Number 8, which is a very good sign after the not nominal static fire last week. Why, you ask? If the damage to Starship Serial Number 8 was so severe, or if the problem with the exploding Raptor engine was a serious design flaw, SpaceX would have most likely done things differently than they did. Our first clue here comes from Mary, aka Boca Chica Gal, for NASASpaceflight.com. These pictures show repair work done on the Starship Serial Number 8 nose cone. It was hard to tell what exactly they did while the work was still going on. But when the work was finished, a small addition could be seen on the nose cone. It's a vent, and very likely this vent leads into the liquid oxygen header tank inside the nose cone tip. After losing the pneumatic system on Starship Serial Number 8 during the last static fire, SpaceX encountered a special problem. Due to the pneumatic system being down, they could not vent the nose cone header tank, and only a burst disc was able to prevent a catastrophic pressure failure. It luckily worked out, but it's far from optimal. To prevent this from happening again, SpaceX engineers instantly added a new vent to the Starship Serial Number 8 nose cone. If this happens again, the Starship will just be able to vent the pressure through this dedicated header tank vent. Why is this the clue that Starship Serial Number 8 will test again soon? If there was no quick solution, SpaceX would have likely not been moving so fast to implement the vent. Right after the static fire, SpaceX workers took out Raptor engine Serial Number 32 for analysis. And it seems they found the problem quickly. Why? The second clue comes in form of a quick engine replacement. Only a day after Raptor engine 32 got taken from under Starship Serial Number 8, SpaceX workers got engine number 42 in place for a quick swap. If there was a serious design flaw on the current Raptor engines, a quick swap wouldn't have done the trick. The engine would have to be redesigned at least in part, and that takes much longer than a day or two. So the problem with Raptor Serial Number 32 might just have been a manufacturing defect. 42 is now in place, ready to give Starship Serial Number 8 a proper push come launch day. This brings me to the conclusion that the testing on Starship Serial Number 8 will continue with almost no interruption. Of course, due to the new engine, we're back to static fires, but the delay should be no more than maybe a week or two, not month. There are no new test dates set as of recording the episode, but I am confident that will change very soon. Looking at the direct surroundings of Starship Serial Number 8, the progress made on the launch site infrastructure can be seen very well from Mauricio's bird's eye perspective. The square concrete foundation between test pads A and B is fully integrated into the surrounding platform. It's still not clear what exactly the purpose of it might be. Ramps leading down towards the container wall have been finished as well. And if we follow the dirt wall further up towards the beach, the fuel lines being built as a connection between tank farm and orbital launch mount can be seen very well. 6 separate lines in 3 groups. Inlet and outlet pipes for oxygen, methane and nitrogen. If we look at the scenery from a wider angle, we can already predict pretty well how the connection will likely be made. Close to the orbital launch mount, SpaceX workers have embedded 2 large concrete boxes into the ground. Those might very well be the terminals for the arriving pipes. If this is correct, the connection will likely be made like this, extending a bit further along Highway 4 and then going straight up towards the orbital launch mount. We're almost there!
Oh my god, that's gonna be a funny blooper.
But what exactly is SpaceX doing here, right between Highway 4 and the orbital launch mount? This is a rather large area. The whole area is leveled, rebar is laying on the ground. What do you think? What might SpaceX be up to here? If you have any idea, tell us in the comments. The Y team needs your support. Give the video a like, subscribe and share it to show the YouTube algorithm that you appreciate the content. Want to give a more direct support? Consider becoming a patron or a YouTube member and get awesome perks like access to our Discord server where I discuss space topics with the community every day. Do you know about the Y Warehouse? Shop for your next Starship shirt or grab our famous Raptor Blueprint shirt and countless other shirts made by space nerds for other space nerds. Links can be found in the description. You rock! Even though Starship Serial Number 8 right now is not even actively testing, there still is so much going on at the site. It's a testament of the incredible dedication every single SpaceX employee is putting into these projects. Thank you, SpaceX. You rock! SpaceX Crew 1 launch summary. The second topic for today is about SpaceX's second and right now equally important project, the Crew Dragon. Since I was not able to stream the launch due to the rather bad timing for the EU, I am giving you a detailed summary of the launch itself and the huge implications this has not only for NASA, but also for SpaceX's future.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Ignition.
Even gravity contains humanity when we explore as one for all.
On November 15th, SpaceX and NASA launched Crew 1, the first operational Crew Dragon flight from Kennedy Space Center's Pad 39A. Due to onshore winds and recovery operations, the launch got shifted by 1 day from November 14th. This needs to be taken into consideration, especially on crewed launches, as not only the launch site weather is important. What you're looking at here is the launch abort corridor for the Crew 1 launch. The green areas show the parts of the flight where the launch abort is safe. The red zone, marked as DAEZ, which stands for Launch Abort Exclusion Zone, is an area in the North Atlantic where the control team wants to avoid an abort due to cold water and rough seas. All this planning directly influences a launch decision, and for November 14th, the recovery conditions would have been rather bad. On November 15th, though, all lights were green and SpaceX and NASA decided to go for launch. Picked for the first operational Crew Dragon flight were Victor Glover, NASA astronaut, Navy commander and pilot on this flight, Dr. Shannon Walker, NASA astronaut and mission specialist, Soichi Noguchi, JAXA astronaut from Japan and also mission specialist, and Mike Hopkins, United States Air Force and NASA astronaut, the commander of this mission to the International Space Station. There was a slight delay right before the launch due to a leak test for the hatch not giving back the expected results. An undisclosed foreign object was found in the door seal and got removed. After this, the hatch sealed just fine and everything continued towards launch.
Termination. SpaceX, go for launch.
At T-minus 45 seconds, the final go for launch was given, and at the exact moment of the instantaneous launch window, the Falcon 9 lit up and launched from historic Pad 39A at Kennedy Space Center. Falcon 9 is becoming a more and more reliable vehicle with every nominal launch, and Booster B1061 did an absolutely perfect job. At T plus 2 minutes and 42 seconds, the booster shut down and stage separation occurred. The second stage with its Merlin vacuum engine took over with a nominal ignition and continued the journey with the Crew Dragon Resilience on top. At T plus 8 minutes and 58 seconds, MVAC shutdown was confirmed and orbital insertion was complete at 27,000 km per hour and an altitude of almost 200 km. Shortly followed by a booster touchdown on the drone ship in the Atlantic Ocean. And I just want to point out here that even though we're already used to this, no other launch provider has achieved something similar to date. And at 12 minutes and 8 seconds, Crew Dragon separation occurred and the vehicle was free from the second stage and on its approach towards the ISS. Absolutely beautiful pictures of the Crew Dragon trunk slowly drifting away from the second stage were broadcasted by SpaceX. The second stage, for those who might be wondering, is deorbited shortly after this and burns up completely on re-entry. Looking inside the Crew Dragon and watching the Crew 1 astronauts work is just incredible, and it shows how much more advanced Crew Dragon really is. Its design and the available space inside make it a 21st century spacecraft, the first of its kind. At around 11 p.m. Eastern Time on November 16th, or around 27 hours after liftoff, the Crew Dragon then docked with the ISS without any problems. This is it. Crew Dragon officially is in business. And yes, I can predict the future. What are the implications for SpaceX? First of all, Crew Dragon is fully certified by NASA and has now entered a long-term contract to ferry astronauts to and from the International Space Station. This, of course, is a very lucrative job for SpaceX, and right now they are still the only company to be able to provide this kind of service to NASA, with Boeing's Starliner being behind schedule. Furthermore, though, SpaceX has almost secretly achieved another very important milestone. Crew Dragon is fully FAA certified. Comparable to an airliner, Crew Dragon is now officially allowed to fly fully private missions. Do not forget, contrary to, for example, on the Space Shuttle, NASA is only a customer on Crew Dragon. They just book flights. And since SpaceX now has the FAA certification, basically anyone else can book a flight too. SpaceX wants to provide Crew Dragon flights not only to NASA astronauts. Next year, for example, if everything goes as planned, Tom Cruise will fly to the ISS to record scenes for a movie. Crew Dragon truly is a 21st century spacecraft. Its implications for SpaceX are broad, and the changes it already brings to the world are profound. Never before was it so cheap to get an astronaut to the ISS. Safe, affordable, and reliable. And if you're looking for something safe and affordable for your digital security, today's sponsor can help. Whether it's data and identity theft, traceability, intrusive advertising, or geo-blocking, Surfshark VPN encrypts your data and enables you to change your virtual location. Have you ever been greeted with a message that this site or video is not available in your country? Streaming services like Netflix or Disney Plus, for example, have vastly different libraries in different countries. Surfshark makes you outsmart them easily by removing the so-called geo-block from your account. Just activate your VPN, change your virtual location, refresh the page, and you're good to go for countless more Netflix and chill evenings. Use my code to get 84% plus 4 extra months for free and at the same time support What About It. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there is no risk. Surf with your own set of rules, links in the description. Today's Patreon and YouTube member shoutout goes to Robert Mestel, Mike Porter, Tate Vinson, and many others. You rock! Thank you very much for your vital support, it makes all this possible. Last but not least, I want to thank the Y team for helping me with everything I couldn't possibly do alone. Quality control, Discord management, subtitle creation, cloud and team management. There are so many aspects of the channel that are almost exclusively managed by the team. I'm working on a little thank you right now and I can't wait for you to get it. You rock! Which is integrated into the common door.
Yes.
These pictures show repair work done. Starship will just be able to vent the pressure through this dedicated headed.
Hey guys, I'm still here.